We'll start with the first question. A popular claim posits that liberal democracy is the best possible political shell for capitalism. You don't necessarily agree. Could you elaborate on that?
Actually, I do agree, but it's always a conditional agreement. So many people on the left, the right, the centre think that liberal democracy is the best possible political system for enabling people to take some sort of control over the government. Winston Churchill even said, democracy is the worst possible political arrangement except for all of the others. Somebody like Milton Friedman says capitalism and democracy are natural bedfellows because the market provides consumer sovereignty and the political system stops an accumulation of wealth influencing the political system. Marx also considered that liberal democracy was the best possible political show. You can explain that in terms of an aphorism of Stanley Moore, who said where exploitation takes the form of exchange, dictatorship can take the form of democracy, because if you give the workers equal rights to sell their labour power and don't oppress them within the labour process, they can also be granted citizenship in the political system. But that's, and you always have a great deal of flexibility in the political system for people to voice their opinions and so forth. But the aphorism I've just given you, where exploitation takes the form of exchange, dictatorship may take the form of democracy, indicates two things: that the worker may be free in the labour market, but inside the labour process they're under the control of capital. You can exercise your vote, but then the state nonetheless determines what happens and so forth. And so that would be the general argument, best possible political shell. But then we have to say under what conditions is that regime sustainable, and I think that might be the topic.
Right. You argue that the shift towards finance-dominated accumulation weakens the link between liberal democracy and capitalism. Could you explain that in greater detail?
Yes. Should we start with the meaning of finance-dominated accumulation? Marxists have written a great deal on money, banking, credit, finance, and so forth, and finance is an essential part of any circuit of capital. So when I talk about finance-dominated accumulation, I'm not just referring to the role of credit or banks in the normal operations of the capitalist economy. What I'm talking about is a situation where finance as a fraction of capital becomes overwhelmingly dominant, not merely in the circulation of credit, but where financial calculation starts to influence every fraction of capital, every worker, and so forth. In other words, finance colonizes everyday life as well as colonizing the operations of all parts of the capitalist world, and is able to do that increasingly because money is no longer backed by gold. Banks create money, and they're able to do it more or less cost-free, which gives them an enormous competitive advantage compared with industrial capital, which actually has to make things before it can make money. Banks make money simply by extending credit. And it completely distorts the operation of the economy because the rates of return to finance are far greater. And they seem effectively now, at least in the Anglo-Saxon economies, to be risk-free of being punished for their activities. And I explain this in terms of a distinction we find most clearly in Weber, but can also be found in Marx, between capital accumulation based on profit-oriented, market-mediated accumulation, and profits that are generated by strong links with the state, with politics. And many people might say the rise of finance is related to the spontaneous operation of market forces. That's completely wrong. It's to deal with unusual deals with political authority, money in, money out, deregulation, decriminalization, promoting opportunities for primitive accumulation through dispossession, protecting banks from punishment for predatory political activities and so forth. And once you abolish the separation between economic and political struggles that was the underpinning of the good functioning of liberal democracy, you have lost the ability to maintain democracy. So you can keep a facade of democracy. People still vote and so forth, but it has no influence on government decisions in key areas. A good example today is the House of Representatives and the Senate passing tax legislation. Lobbyists have seen the bill. Normal senators and people in the House of Representatives haven't, especially on the Democratic side. Deals done in the dead of night to satisfy financial and industrial interests. That's not democracy. It's the appearance of democracy, but nobody really recognizes it as such. And that's one of the reasons why you get phenomena like right-wing populism, Trump. You have to clear the swamp, and the swamp is partly the product of finance-dominated accumulation.
So when you say the link weakens, when the accumulation process is finance-led, do you think it moves towards authoritarian statism, as some people argue, or do you see another development?
Statism is a more general trend. It was being discussed already in the 1970s, before neoliberalism, before the rise of finance-dominated accumulation. So we can see the rise of finance-dominated accumulation in the context of growing authoritarian statism. What it does is to give a particular inflection, a particular direction to authoritarian statism. It intensifies far more the need to limit public control, democratic control over the state. And in particular, what I think we're seeing is a specific development of authoritarian statism, which I call the rise of the permanent state of austerity. Austerity occurs in many contexts. We can think of austerity as conjunctural policies. When the economy is overheating, a little bit of austerity. That's what we find in the history of Germany, United Kingdom, and so forth. We can move then from the policies of austerity to the politics of austerity. And I see that as the main contribution, if it's a contribution, to politics of neoliberals, arguing the state spends too much, we shrink the state with much money is being spent on entitlements, welfare, and so forth. We have to roll back the state, and that means also calling for austerity. But that, until recently, was a political program. What we're seeing now is the translation of that program into radical transformations of the state within the context of authoritarian statism. And that is, how does one organize the state to impose austerity? And that, of course, means a lot of resistance, a lot of resentment about rolling back welfare benefits, making for greater precarity, and so forth. And in order to maintain and to impose austerity, you need radically to strengthen the state, far more than we would find in authoritarian statist regimes elsewhere. So all of these things are closely interconnected. The transformation in the circuits of capital, the rise of the financial fraction of capital, its ability then to reorganize the ways in which neoliberalism finance operates in the economy, but that has repercussions for the state. So a permanent state of austerity within the framework of increasing authoritarian statism.